Welcome back to Let's Play Mass Effect Andromeda Blind. I'm the RPG chick, finally getting to the Codex. If you don't want to hear me read Codex for an entire video, or two, or something, not sure how long I'm going to go with it. I'm sure there's plenty. Then feel free to skip this episode, and some people do like hearing me read it, so I guess then don't skip the episode. Anyway, finally getting to it. Right, so we have all these categories. Haven't even looked here. Okay. So the journey so far, as you explore Andromeda, the allies, enemies, and choices you make will have a significant impact on the future of Helios and those who call the cluster home. Finding a home. The Helios cluster is nothing like the Initiative expected. The Pathfinder faces terrible dangers and unimaginable wonders in the search for a safe place to call home. Crisis on Habitat 7. During your trial by fire on Habitat 7, you tried to initiate peaceful first contact with the Ket despite their hostility, explored an alien laboratory, found a cave full of plant life that survived from the planet's Golden World era, rescued Greer from his captives, and expressed doubts about accepting the role of Pathfinder. Oh, so we got a little history of stuff here. Oh, wait. We've got different things. Oh, this is our journal? And then we've got... Alright, let me just read this first. Eos, the first outpost. You explored and reactivated a mysterious alien vault, apparently designed for terraforming, bringing the hope of new life back to Eos. Despite the potential cat threat, you guided the outpost on Eos on a mission of peaceful, scientific exploration of the Helios cluster. First contact, the Angara. You proved yourself an ally to the Angara by aiding their fight against the cat on Vold. Okay, so what are these things? Journal. Okay, this is just a quest log. Oh, this is a map. Okay, wait. Codex. Oh, these are actually... This is not part of Codex. Got it. These are our profiles and other such things. Okay. So this alone is Codex. Got it. So these are the things under finding a home, and then a crew like no other. Only the best and most experienced crew can hope to succeed on the Pathfinder's mission. These allies and companions ensure survival for thousands of settlers. Nakmor Drak. After earning Nakmor Drak's respect on Eos, he agreed to join your squad. The Tempest is a little cozy for a Krogan, but the old-timers made himself comfortable. When not regaling the crew with stories, he hangs out in the galley, tinkering with his guns. Drak was one of many Krogan awoken from stasis to help put down a mutiny on a Nexus. When the Krogan weren't given the authority they were promised, his people left to settle Helios their own way. Drak's granddaughter Kesh stayed on the Nexus. He might say she's keeping them honest. A mid-level politician named William Spender was the one who talked the Krogan into putting down a Nexus mutiny under false pretenses. Drak and Kesh both suspect Spender's connected to Exiles, but can't prove it. They ask you to help investigate. Cora Harper. You've socialized a little with Cora, learning more about her background as a biotic and a sorry commando. Wow, they really don't say hardly anything about her in comparison to Nakmor. Kallo Jath. You and Kallo sometimes chat in your free time. Kallo will take any excuse to talk about the Tempest. Kallo's growing rift with Gil Brody is becoming hard to ignore. Yeah, we've talked to him about it. Liam Costa. First impressions of Liam. He's a real booster for the Initiative and always gives his all for the mission. Lexi Tapero. Despite her years of experience, Lexi feels a little daunted by working in the field. However, she is excited about the prospect of researching the cat. P.B. Basale. P.B. is becoming your resident expert on remnant technology, but she's maintaining her distance from the team. Your relationship has turned flirty. Vetranix. Vetra likes to describe herself as someone who gets things done. She seems very committed to your mission and the Pathfinder team's success. The fact that she brought her sister Cid with her to Andromeda might have something to do with her dedication. Gil Brody. You've left Gil to his job taking care of the Tempest systems, which seems to keep him busy. You've shot the breeze with Gil a few times, and he's invited you to hang out socially and share his favorite pastime, poker. Suvi Anwar. Suvi Anwar is the Tempest's resident science officer. She works closely with the research team on the Nexus, analyzing the data you and Sam collect in the field. While chatting, Suvi revealed herself to be a spiritual person. You expressed your own similar feelings on the matter. Suvi appreciated finding someone of like mind.
Cool.
Wait. Oh, Jal. Jal Amar Daraf has joined the Pathfinder team. His good intentions to help you gain the trust of the Angara seem sincere. However, he's keeping you at arm's length for now, and it seems you'll need to gain his trust, too. Ryder. The Pathfinder is more than a title. Like everyone else in the initiative, Ryder must decide who to become in the new frontier of Helios. Ongoing psychological profile. Pathfinder Ryder. From the files of Tempest, physician and psychologist Dr. Lexi DePero. Oh, great. So I'm being psychologically examined. Ryder, I've completed a more thorough evaluation for now. This is what I am delivering to Pathfinder H... Ryder, I've completed a more thorough evaluation. For now, this is what I'm delivering to Pathfinder HQ. I may send you updates later, if applicable. You exhibit heart and empathy in many situations. Also, the passion that you bring to your role as Pathfinder does not go unnoticed by those who work alongside you. In fact, it may be a key component in drawing others to you. However, I would say that this is completely in line with your tendency to act impulsively in many situations, to go with your gut rather than pause and wait for more information. In brackets here, or parentheses, perhaps I should note that you are more impulsive in the field than you are with your affection. Whatever that means, we can keep that between us. I would add, although you've had to quickly adjust to take on a new and unexpected role, you maintain a direct and professional demeanor. My guess is that your former military training and subsequent experience with command structure is serving you well here. Or perhaps a solid and respectful approach to things is just your nature. Yeah, I tend to take the more professional versus casual. I don't choose the casual that often. The rest can be split. I choose the heart and empathy. The ties that bind. You still mourn the loss of your father, Alec, a man you love and loved and respected. You hope you'd have made him proud as Pathfinder. You started a search for answers to the mystery about why your father made you Pathfinder. You visited your brother Scott while he was still in a coma. You lied to your brother and told him your dad was still alive. You were honest with Scott about the struggles you faced in finding home. Now, if he even remembers that, of course, that's going to be something that comes up. Exploring Helios. Uncharted worlds and mysterious regions of space fill the Helios cluster. The Pathfinder's journeys touch the lives of all who inhabit these places. An ancient mind. You obey the wishes of an ancient Angaran AI unfold and destroyed it. That's what it wanted? It wanted me to destroy it? I guess. I didn't realize that, I guess. It made me do it. That's right. It gave me an ultimatum so that I would destroy it. Okay. The Andromeda Initiative category. The initiative was built by the efforts of thousands who devoted years of time and countless resources to reach the Andromeda Galaxy. These are the people, places, and organizations that made the Pathfinder's mission possible. Known associates. Dossiers on Pathfinder Rider's friends, allies, and contacts across the Helios cluster. PB. Okay, so now we have more information here. PB describes herself freely as the foremost Milky Way expert on the remnant and their technology. It is difficult to verify her qualifications for this, as many Nexus personnel records have been lost. DNA and fingerprint matches give you the name Pelissaria Basale, although according to the revival schedule, that individual should still be in stasis. PB's only comment is, nothing like getting a head start. Piecing together information from Eos and the Nexus, PB was born on the planet Hyatiana in the Milky Way. After voyaging to Andromeda on the Nexus, she left the station some months ago to explore the Helios cluster alone and became fascinated by the remnant. She has classified and dismantled several types of remnant bot, but she prefers to keep her findings private for now. Psychologically, PB demonstrates both extremely high intelligence and hyper-individualism. Her restlessness is typical of many Asari in their maiden phase of life, though few go so far as to visit another galaxy. Yeah, say that. Kalojath. Kalojath was born on Sirkash, and quoting directly, into a life so boring even you couldn't calculate it. Pushed towards a lucrative but dull bureaucratic career with Aerospace, Kalo became more interested in flying the starships he was meant to be cataloging. He eventually left Sirkash for formal pilot training and joined Perot's competitor as a test pilot. Internal emails show that when the Andromeda Initiative was building teams to develop their survey vessels, Perot Aerospace warned against recruiting Kalo so fervently that Jen Gerson's interest was piqued. Kalo claims that the prospect of the Initiative was intriguing enough to make him join the Tempest design team, test flying her early prototypes, running stress tests in regions like the Nemean Abyss, and rumor has it, helping to acquire, quote-unquote, advanced technology. Kalo has an acute photographic memory, even by Solarian standards. This may be linked to his unusual motor responses, though he discourages my speculation. Vetranix. Well, who's writing this? Writer? Or is it, what's her name again? Lexi. The Andromeda Initiative's records on Vetranix are sparse. She states that she is from Palavin, but has also disclosed that she is not recognized as the formal citizen of Turian society, never having entered boot camp. It appears she left Palavin at an early age and spent most of her life in the outer reaches of Council space, never settling down in one place. Vetra was recruited into the Initiative by Nakmor Kesh, who lists her as a business associate, and recommended her on the basis of her street smarts, adaptability, and familiarity with most weapons. Vetra's only other recorded family is her sister, Sidera Nix, who accompanied Vetra on her journey to Andromeda on board the Nexus. You know, that reminds me of Sidaris, who, if I remember right, that was a... Crap. It was a loyalty mission, and we were helping Well, I can't remember his name. Our Turian friend. We were helping him to, I guess, take down Sidaris, because Sidaris left his team to die or something like that. If I have that right. A footnote in Vetra's file indicates that she may have been part of an unnamed mercenary band that was hired to steal sensitive military secrets from a base on Manai. The culprits were never caught. It's killing me. It's on the tip of my tongue. I can't remember his name. Formerly known as Archangel at one point. Crap. I obviously know the name, guys. It's when a name's on the tip of your tongue like that. Gonna come to me. Maybe in this episode. Technical Officer Gil Brody is a chief engineer aboard the Tempest. After traveling to Andromeda aboard the Nexus, records show that Gil was woken from stasis roughly a year ago to assist with construction efforts before prepping the Tempest itself. Garrus. His name's Garrus. It would come to me. There are no records of Gil's early life. He explains he was an undocumented street kid from one of Earth's megapolis cities. Though unschooled, Gil likely showed a remarkable aptitude for mathematics and spatial reasoning, since at 10, he often broke into a local scrapyard to dismantle and repair damaged or destroyed shuttle engines. In time, he was caught and sentenced to a steady job. Gil's mechanical expertise eventually drew him off-world to numerous colonies across the Milky Way. His unconventional work drew the attention of veteran Nix, who agrees she was always on the lookout for new contacts. Vetra claims she persuaded Gil to join the initiative. Gil claims he won Vetra's initiative clearance in a poker game and exchanged it for a guaranteed seat along with his friend Jill. He remains an invaluable member of the Tempest crew. A guaranteed seat at the poker game? So we got Jill and Gil? Well, maybe we'll meet her at the poker game. I don't know. Lexi Taparo. Although young by Asari standards, Lexi Taparo is regarded as one of the most skilled doctors in the Andromeda Initiative. Born on the crime-ridden space station Omega, Lexi began her medical career by stitching up her father, a Turian bouncer at the Afterlife nightclub, where her mother was also employed as a dancer. In her screening interviews, Lexi states her parents' dream was for her to get off this rock and live a life worth talking about. Following her parents' wishes, Lexi left Omega to continue studying medicine as well as psychology on the Citadel, where she eventually met Harry Carlyle. Carlyle convinced her to join the initiative as the Hyperion's physician. Although there was some confusion around assigning Asari to the human arc, Lexi's credentials and expertise in alien anatomy quickly silenced any concerns. By her own admission, Lexi is a workaholic. On or off the table, I have a hard time not dissecting people. Figuratively, of course. One of her many goals in Helios is to improve her bedside manner and learn to, quote-unquote, appreciate the moment. Neckmore Drac. Love that name. As verified by Nexus Records and his own claims, the Krogan mercenary Neckmore Drac is among the oldest beings to join the Andromeda Initiative. He originally traveled on the Nexus along with many other members of Clan Neckmore, but left after the Nexus Uprising. Born on Tuchanka around 700 CE, Drac was a young warrior when the Krogan rebellions began in earnest. He and his Krant, is that like clan, accounted for over 200 kills, which Drac claims includes three of the then newly founded Council Spectres. He killed three Council Spectres? Or three Council Spectres were in his Krant. I'm thinking the former? But why would he kill Council Spectres? After the Solarian design genophage ended the rebellions, various bounties and military bulletins show Drac chose a new path as a pirate and soldier of fortune for whatever conflicts came his way. Oh, because he's taking part in the rebellions, that's why he killed Spectres. Got it. Over centuries of fighting, multiple injuries required several of his limbs and organs to be replaced by cybernetics. Eventually, Drac says, his search for one last horizon brought him to Andromeda. Drac did not travel alone. He accompanied most of his clan to Andromeda, including granddaughter Neckmore Kesh and clan leader Neckmore Morda. Kesh and Drac maintain a close relationship, exchanging regular messages no matter where their duties in Helios take them. Sam. Self-examination being important for sentient beings, I was encouraged to write this entry by Alec Ryder. Okay, so Sam's writing all these. That's cool. I am a simulated adaptive matrix, SAM, a new generation artificial intelligence. Unlike most AI, I link to a neural implant that gives me access to my host's sensory and emotional responses. Put simply, I have a direct understanding of the human experience, which allows me to grow beyond the bounds of logical programming. In return, I lend my quantum computing power and rational analysis to a Pathfinder's mission. I am physically located in a server bank installed in SAM node aboard the Ark Hyperion, but quantum entanglement technology allows instant communication anywhere, in the event of catastrophic injury or death. Protocol dictates that my command access be transferred to the next Pathfinder candidate in line. Scott Ryder. Born your younger twin on the Citadel Space Station in 2163, Scott grew up knowing the station was a gateway to the entire Milky Way. In his orientation interviews, he claims this fostered a longing to step through those gateways to adventure. With informal training aided by Alec Ryder's N7 background, Scott joined the Systems Alliance military and was assigned to an outpost near Arcturus Station overseeing Relay 202. A primary route to Arcturus, this mass relay leads into contested space and has an unsavory reputation. Scott was needed to protect Arcturus, but also had, quote-unquote, a front-row seat to everyone else going off to fortune and glory. When Alec Ryder was dishonorably discharged due to his AI research, internal memos show that this also effectively ended Scott's career, making Andromeda a more attractive option for the adventure he sought. Interesting. On arrival in Andromeda, Scott's cryopad was damaged and his revival process interrupted. Dr. Lexi Tapero advised keeping him in a medically induced coma to allow him to awaken naturally. Alec Ryder. Born on Earth in 2129, Alec Ryder says his love of new frontiers was fostered by a childhood in the Sierra Nevadas. According to his service record, he joined the Alliance military and was eventually assigned to John Grissom's historic expedition to the Charon Relay. His experience made him a candidate for what would later be known as N7 training back on Earth, where he met Dr. Ellen Harlow. After their marriage, Alec continued military service, most notably on Shang-Chi, in the First Contact War against the Turians. Assigned as a military attaché to the Citadel in the late 2160s, Alec became interested in artificial intelligence as a means of human advancement. His pursuit of this illegal technology led to a dishonorable discharge from the Alliance military. Contacted by the Andromeda Initiative, Alec found a sponsor to help complete his work. I am the product of that research, assisting not only the Initiative, but Alec's new role as the Pathfinder. Soon after our arrival on Andromeda, in 2819, Alec Ryder died during operations on Habitat 7. Cora Harper. See, now we get to read about her. Lieutenant Cora Harper, service number 6002-AC-1762, is a human biotic and formerly an officer in the Systems Alliance military. Her screening interviews state she was raised in poverty on an independent cargo fighter, joining the Alliance at 18 to obtain training for her powerful biotic abilities. However, Cora claims her superiors saw her talents as a liability, supported by test scores showing her abilities spike at abnormally high levels. She was transferred via the Citadel Council's Valkyrie program, a subset of their interspecies military integration plan, and placed with the Asari commando unit Talane's Daughters. Though the activities of Asari huntresses are typically sealed for 5,000 years, Cora has freely shared her experiences on the record, peacekeeping, counterterrorism, and hunting fugitives. When she left Talane's Daughters for the Andromeda Initiative, no reason is recorded, Cora's huntress training and biotic capability made her a candidate for Alec Ryder's second-in-command and, if warranted, his successor as Pathfinder. Well, that did not happen. Jal Amadarav is a trusted member of the Angaran Resistance, who has chosen to join the crew of the Tempest to observe and assess us. With our contact with the Angaran species in its earliest days, Jal is thankfully forthcoming on the subject of himself and his people. What records Jal has made available show he is a middle child of a large and prestigious family. He was raised by multiple mothers, apparently customary for Angara, listening to tales of his family's heroic deeds and scientific discoveries from a young age. At 16, he followed in his grandmother's footsteps to fight against the cat, joining the organized Angaran resistance as a tracker, scout, and extremely skilled sniper. In time, Jal established himself as Ephra's trusted lieutenant. Though I only have a small baseline for Angara, voice stress and body language analysis suggest Jal feels familial pressure to achieve his own heroic status. Jal himself says only that, quote-unquote, everyone needs their own story. Suvi Anwar. Suvi Anwar is a member of the Nexus's science team and holds advanced degrees in astrophysics and molecular biology. In a screening interview, she stated that she was from a large, rather boisterous family of five children. Her neuroscientist mother and mathematician father exposed her and her siblings to science from a young age, which sparked a lifelong love of the subject. While pursuing her PhD in molecular biology, Suvi was handpicked for a team doing cutting-edge biophysical and cybernetics research. After a year, the team was headhunted by a black ops organization for a classified biomedical project. Suvi was extended an invitation but declined, opting to refocus her attention on her own projects. She declares that there was no hesitation on her part in signing up for the Andromeda Initiative once she learned of its existence, owing to a desire to see and experience more than one small corner of this vast universe. Liam Costa. Liam Costa is a human security and crisis response specialist with civilian tactical training, period. His screening interview states that he was born on Earth, but his parents specialized in interplanetary policy law, and the family moved frequently. Their primary resistance was split between London and the Citadel. Liam entered university for engineering, but left to train for law enforcement. Though initially driven, he was only briefly stationed as a police officer and described leaving as a necessary move for all concerned. He transitioned to the multi-species effort of heavy urban research and crisis response. If Liam was disillusioned in law enforcement, service records show that that was not mirrored in crisis response. The human contingent, Heavy Urban Search Terrain 1, reported that Liam performed exceptionally in all conditions. Liam states or says that this is when he learned of the Andromeda Initiative, after meeting former Alliance personnel at a post-hostility relief action. His multidisciplinary skills set him apart, and Liam was handpicked by Alec Ryder to support the Pathfinder team. Dr. Ellen Ryder. Oh. Her mother. Well, I've never seen what she looks like. Formerly Harlow, was a pioneering designer of bionic implants. In the 2150s, she was a leading biomedical and cybernetic researcher at UFRJ, what that is, in Rio de Janeiro, United Forces, Rio de Janeiro, when human bionics began to emerge as a scientific field. Ellen found possible applications for her work in neuro-integrated wetware. Her early designs for bionic implants formed the framework for later L2 and L3 models. Ellen met Alec Ryder when he was posted to Rio for ICT N7 training before the First Contact War. She eventually joined Alec on the Citadel when he was posted there as a military attaché and gave birth to fraternal twins on the station in 2163. Unfortunately, Element Zero, the catalyst for biotic mutations, is a hazardous material, poorly understood in the early years of human biotics. After repeat accidental exposures, Ellen eventually developed a terminal neurodegenerative disorder, later known as AEND. In her final years, Ellen Ryder built what would later become the Pathfinder implants designed to sync with the AI partner Alec Ryder was developing. Ellen died before my creation was fully realized. How sad. Okay, guys, so that's known associates. So, we're coming up on a half hour. So I'm going to call an episode here. Going to do another one. Yeah, I'm going to read some more. I get further into the Codex here. Not sure how many I'll do. Let's see how my voice lasts throughout all this. Thanks so much for watching. See you next time, and endure. In enduring, grow strong.